largest product testing firm will soon be screening products claiming to be environmentally friendly. Underwriters Laboratories has agreed to evaluate the claims of manufacturers seeking the new...
Could I have the roll call by the town clerk, please?
Chairman Creelman?
Here.
Councilor Amaral? Councilor Chapel?
Here.
Councilor Cogstall?
Here.
Councilor Jordan?
No.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Councilor Pearson?
Here.
Would you all please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, I have two sets of minutes. Minutes number 3 of the town council meeting held July 8, 1991, and minutes number 4 held on July 11, 1991. What is your wishes?
Mr. Chairman, I move they be accepted as printed.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Okay, unanimous vote. Thank you very much. And at this portion of the meeting, we have citizens' discussion of items that are not on the agenda this evening. Are there citizens in the audience this evening who would like to address an issue from the podium? Seeing none, I will close that portion of the meeting. At this point, I would like to myself come down to the podium and make two presentations. Could I have the women's tennis team of Cape Elizabeth please come down to the podium this evening? All representatives come at once. Good evening. I know the coach. This is Betsy Hughes. I'm sorry, I don't know you. Very good to meet you, sir. It's my pleasure this evening to read this proclamation given to the Cape Elizabeth girls tennis team. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School girls tennis team has won the main Class B championship, and whereas this victory marks the second consecutive state championship, and whereas both the students and coaches should be congratulated for an outstanding season, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate the state champion Cape Elizabeth girls tennis team, and we thank them for representing our community so well, dated this 12th day of August 1991 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine. Thank you very much.
I'd just like to thank the town council for this honor, and I want to tell you how much the girls have done their role, been a credit to the school and to the town. We've had an outstanding group this year. This is Sarah Newcomb, who has been one of our top singles players, and who also is number 3 or 4 in the state. Next year will probably be ranked number 3 in the girls' high school tournament. She also was a recipient of the Prince Award for All-American, only given to 6 girls in the state. And she was one of them, and our other one that got it was Aaron Wentworth, who was on vacation. Thank you very much.
And can we now have the Cape Elizabeth High School boys lacrosse team please come down to the podium with their coach, Mr. Charlie Birch. Gentlemen, why don't you just make a little crescent here so the cameras can see everyone. Great. This evening, I'd also like to present a second proclamation, and this is, as I said earlier, to the Cape Elizabeth boys lacrosse team. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School boys lacrosse team has recently won the main Class B championship, And whereas each member of the team has contributed his own talents throughout the entire year, and whereas the town appreciates the support and supervision that the coaching staff has provided to these students, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth High School Boys Lacrosse Team, and we thank them for representing Cape Elizabeth so well. Dated this 12th day of August, 1991, at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, and this is signed by all of the town councilors. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Mr. Birch.
Thank you.
Delighted.
I have with me tonight, from my right to left here, Jeff Dubois, Seth Flynn, Ted Gilbreth, Chris Root, Devin Wilson, and Troy Graham. Pretty good representation of guys to get together in the middle of the summertime. I'd also like to thank the town council for this recognition. We've won the state championship 2 years in a row ourselves now, and again, these boys do a very fine job for me and for the school and represent their families and the school and the town of Cape Elizabeth very well. We hope to see you up again here again next year, I guess. Thank you very much.
At this point of the evening, I would like to talk about some of the reports and correspondence that have floated in since our last meeting. I have two pieces myself that I'll begin with. The first is to let the citizens of Cape Elizabeth know that recently, back on August 1st, the United States Senate Commerce Committee approved an amendment as part of the Coast Guard reauthorization bill. This particular amendment was drafted by George Mitchell's staff, and this is an amendment that would convey Portland Headlight to Cape Elizabeth, allowing Cape Elizabeth to become the owner of the lighthouse under an amendment that we hope will be passed by the full Senate when it comes up after the Senate returns to Washington from their recess. Under the Mitchell Amendment, the Coast Guard would convey the title of Portland Head Lighthouse to the town of Cape Elizabeth, and the town would guarantee the Coast Guard access it needs to maintain and operate the remaining navigational aid. So we're keeping our fingers crossed and delighted and very appreciative of Senator Mitchell's work in this regard, who has been tirelessly coming to bat for us from the very beginning of our hope that this would become part of Cape Elizabeth. And secondly, I would like to acknowledge a letter received today from the four riders and the project coordinator of Cape Elizabeth Past to Present. A week ago Thursday, the town council hosted a reception marking the publication of this book and honoring its authors. Tonight, for the official record, I would once again like to thank Marcelia Berry, Miriam Chapman, Constance Murray, and Elizabeth Peterson for providing to the community an excellent popular history of Cape Elizabeth. At that evening, I had read about a third of the book. However, over the past week, I had an opportunity to read the publication from cover to cover and recommend it highly to all those present and to those who may be watching. It's available at the Town Hall and at the Thomas Memorial Library. I understand the Preservation Society plans to sell it at the Labor Day weekend art show at Fort Williams Park, and it will be on sale at the new Portland Head Light gift shop when it opens in early fall. The book is fascinating, and I again wish to thank the authors and project coordinator Jane Jordan for all their work in making it a reality for Cape Elizabeth. Thank you very, very much. And only one other point. I would like to congratulate our town clerk this evening. She was number one in her class, culminating a three-year program at the New England Clerks Institute, and deserves a hearty applause for all of us. Are there other reports and correspondence, please? Janet, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
As a lot of you are aware, we in Cape Elizabeth initiated a petition petitioning the Public Utilities Commission in Augusta to hold a public hearing on a proposed rate increase by the Portland Water District. The goal was to obtain 1,000 signatures. If we reach that goal, then legally the PUC is obligated to host a public hearing at which we will be able to discuss the proposed rate increase. Proposal is for a 25% increase over each of the next 3 years. At that public hearing that I'm feeling very confident about that will take place, we will also bring up a discussion of the town-city rate differential that a lot of people are probably for the first time becoming aware of. This is just the start of a lot of work that we'll need to continue, and I think we've done an excellent job at raising awareness of people both within Cape Elizabeth and within the Portland Water District service area. I want to make some very special thank yous. We've had wonderful cooperation from the townsfolk, and there are three businesses in particular I would like to publicly thank, those being Bragdon's Hardware, Maxwell's Farm Market, and Tony's House of Pizza. We did have petitions at all three of those businesses, and if you weren't at Tony's House of Pizza, you missed the hot spot in town the last 2.5 weeks. I think for a while you couldn't get your pizza unless you signed the petitions. So Tony and Kim did a fantastic job for us, as did Bragdon's and Maxwell's. We had a lot of citizens within Cape Elizabeth circulating petitions, one of whom, Dr. McManamy, is in our audience tonight, and thank you publicly also, sir, as well as town councilors who did a very nice job, and I'll thank all my fellow councilors. We had town councilors in Gorham in the person of Carol Day and in Falmouth in the person of Pace Pace, and we also helping to circulate. We also had petitions, I believe, at the town offices in the town of Cumberland. I especially want to thank all the citizens who signed this. It was an overwhelming response, as I was correctly quoted in the newspaper saying it was the easiest petition I'd ever dealt with, and people, yes, did grab it out of my hands to sign it. They were very enthusiastic about signing it. As somebody said, well, this is some, gives us some people power, and I think just facilitating that feeling in people was a very good start. We do have to make one more thank you, and I want everyone who signed this to know that they owe a debt of gratitude to our town manager, Michael McGovern, both for his initiative and for his persistence in this matter. And he will be taking the petitions. These are only photocopies. The real ones are in the safe. That many. He's taking them up to the PUC in Augusta tomorrow. And the count we have, and I've got to do some adding here. Wow. 1,744. That is fantastic. Thank you, everybody. Good going.
Thank you very much, Councillor McLaughlin. Our town manager is going to give us a bit of an update with respect to the National Guard at Fort Williams.
I wanted to give you a brief update. At the request of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, the National Guard has been doing some work for us out at Fort Williams. Specifically, they're improving the parade ground parking lot, as well as building a new central parking lot that's part of the Fort Williams master plan. It is going to be causing some inconveniences during the time that it's under construction, particularly in the parade ground lot. Some of you may have noticed the barricades and the area that's dug up there, but as a result of having the National Guard do it, it does take longer, but we do save a significant amount of funds that can be utilized for other improvements at the park. So I would like to publicly thank the National Guard, and as well as everyone who's utilizing the park, for their understanding while the work is being done. Thank you.
Councilor Chappell.
Yes, sir. The regional waste services or systems annual meeting was July the 25th. From Cape Elizabeth, we had our town manager, Michael McGovern. We had Lester Jordan and myself. It was quite an evening for Cape Elizabeth. They honored Lester for his eight-plus years as a member of the board of Regional Waste Systems. He got a little ash can with a top on it for a little plaque, and then he got a nice big plaque that stated his service, the boards that he'd been on, and his trips that he'd made, and quite a few humorous stories about his trips to Europe and throughout the country. And the first thing he wanted to know when he hit a new town is, what's the best restaurant? So it was a good night for Cape Elizabeth, and a good night for Lester Jordan. I was very pleased for him, and Cape Elizabeth can be very proud of the work that he did. I felt pretty good when they got to the nominations, the nomination committee. I'd been to one meeting, and sometimes I guess it pays just to keep quiet now and then, and they nominated me to be on the finance committee for next year, so I appreciated that. It was a good meeting. I have one little thing to finish up my report for the chairman of the town council. I was worried about size, but I didn't have to worry because they were all extra large, so I'm sure it'll fit you, Wayne. I brought this all the way back and kept it secret all this time.
Well, thank you very much, Eric. Waste that works. Let me model all this for the entire viewing community this evening. That's very, very helpful, Eric. A perfect fit, you might add.
Extra, extra large?
Extra large. Are there, it's going to be tough to beat that one, but are there other reports or correspondence this evening? Councilor McLaughlin.
It's always so hard to follow Councilor Chappell. In my excitement, I want to say I found 10 more signatures. It's 1,754, corrected. I can't add too well sometimes. One other meeting I've had a few weeks ago, I was invited to join with some of our school department personnel and attend a total quality management one-day seminar that the school department was involved in because of their association with an assistance program at University of Southern Maine. And the seminar was put on at Unum. Very interestingly, it was the director of the seminar was a Cape resident, Roger Rio, and I found it a very educational and worthwhile day. The basis of it is to initiate some new management techniques and ideas, starting with the custodians and bus drivers within the school personnel ranks. There were members of those groups there. There were teachers and administrators and school board members and myself. As I said, I totally enjoyed it, and I will keep the council up to date on what else I learn about this. Thank you.
Thank you. Further reports. Councilor Carter.
I would just like to say it's probably not such an exciting as is time, but last Sunday I attended along with the manager and our chairman to the gentleman of Cape Elizabeth, which is very sharp, celebrated his 100th birthday. And he is very smart, and he says, "I'll walk in." And he stood there, shook hands with many people before we had to sit down and relax a little bit. And he's very pleased with the proclamation that the chairman made to the group that was there. I think it was a great event. And I told him I'd see him at his 100th first.
And his name was?
His name was Leonard Dunham.
That was quite an achievement. Very, very delightful ceremony to be a part of. Councilor Pearson.
Yes, if I may, Chairman Creelman. A couple weeks ago, I had the honor of attending a testimonial for Donald L. Richards, the retiring coach of the Cape Elizabeth swim team and also a math instructor at the school. And this was a testimonial that was put on by some of his former swimmers. And it was just a way to say goodbye. And thanks a lot for all you've done to Cape Elizabeth school swim team and the community. And it was a very moving, touching ceremony that had family members, past competing coaches that have worked with and against Don Richards. And I also sat in for Counselor Amaro and read the official notice that the town council and the school board will be naming the Cape Elizabeth Swimming Pool the Donald L. Richards Pool. So that was quite an experience.
Thank you. Okay, seeing no other hands, I will close this portion of the meeting and we will proceed to a series of public hearings this evening. The first is the Paputic Club Games of Chance public hearing. This is item number 46 on the agenda. To consider approving a request from the Paputic Club to conduct Games of Chance on September 7, 1991 and take any necessary action, and I will defer to our town clerk, Mrs. Pizzo.
Thank you very much. The Paputic Club has applied for several different tables for this evening. They include blackjack 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, Wheel of Fortune, Chuck-a-Luck, and a poker table. The applications have been submitted and they are ready for council action.
I would ask for a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Do we have any input from citizens? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and ask for a vote at this time. All in favor for this particular motion? It is unanimous. Thank you very much. The second public hearing this evening involves the Inn by the Sea liquor license. This is item number 47. To consider approving an application from Susan T. Ledge Events Incorporated and Ronald M. Griffith, trustee of Inn by the Sea Realty Trust, for a full-time malt, spiritus, and Venus liquor license for the Inn by the Sea on Bowery Beach Road, and take any necessary action. Do we have anyone from the Inn by the Sea that wanted to present any information on this particular license? Sir, could you come down to the podium, please, and just tell us what your name is and your address, please?
My name is Gordon Scannell. I'm a lawyer at Bell and Dana representing the Inn by the Sea Realty Trust. And just by way of background, this is currently a liquor license. It's operating now. The situation here, there's a deed in lieu of foreclosure, and the bank will be taking title, and the current one of the applicants, Susan T. Legg, who's in the audience, is operating the restaurant and in now, and this is essentially, we understood that we could not continue operation. We couldn't assume their license. We had to apply for a new license, so that's what this situation is. There's no change in management of the restaurant.
Thank you very much. I really should have asked our town clerk, Mrs. Pizzo, to actually precede the input, so I'm going to ask her to do that right now with respect to the orderliness of this particular license.
Thank you. The town council does have in their packets the application that is completed. The application is the same as when it was held by the Inn by the Sea. The only change is that there are two applicants for this application. It is for a full-time malt, spirituous, and Venus hotel liquor license. And it's ready for council action.
Thank you, Tibby. The public hearing is open. Are there any other individuals in the audience who wish to say anything with respect to this particular item this evening? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and at this point ask for a motion.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion on this item? All those in favor? It is a unanimous vote. Thank you very much. The next item this evening is a public hearing on traffic regulations, item number 48, to consider proposed amendments to the traffic schedule prohibiting parking on Shore Road from Route 77 to the northerly property line of 1226 Shore Road and along the new driveway connecting the town hall lot to Shore Road, and to take any necessary action, and I will defer to our town manager at this time.
Currently, there is no parking on Shore Road for 350 feet from its intersection with Route 77. Under this proposal, it would extend down to the end of the property that's now owned by the town at 1226 Shore Road on both sides. Furthermore, there would be no parking, or under the way this was set, no stopping at any time on the driveway connecting the town hall lot with Shore Road. These were set for public hearing. We did send notices to all of the abutters, as well as advertised it in the newspaper. It was reviewed by the zoning board in reference to the no stopping requirement. They did unanimously vote at their last meeting that Section 13, they would not have objection if it simply read no parking at any time on the driveway connecting the town hall out with Shore Road. They were agreeable to removing the no stopping provision following the council's desires.
Thank you very much, Mr. McGovern. I will now open this for public input. Are there any individuals in the audience this evening who would like to make a comment on this particular item?
My name is McManamy. I live at 1208 Shore Road. We use Shore Road to get to 77 frequently during the days and consistently through the years, and I have to pass by 1226 all the time. I'm opposed to any parking on Shore Road, and I'm a little concerned about where you want to start the parking. As you come around the corner from Casco Bank, you immediately have two entrance and exits. You have Casco Bank, and then you have the little shopping center and the dentist place next door to it. And I think it's bad. I think you should not have any parking on Shore Road at all. I'm opposed to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your input. Please, I see another hand back there. Please come right down to the microphone.
Steve Pagioli, I'm here for another public hearing, but I have a question on this. When you refer to the parking, are you talking about just where is the actual line on this? Are you talking on the hot top or on the shoulder or what?
This is for...
The reason I'm asking is because of the scout house.
Yeah. No parking provisions apply to on-street parking.
Okay, so just the, but in different towns, the street continues beyond the actual paved path. Do you have like an 8-foot differential from the hot top, or are you talking just basically on the hot top?
I've never known, you know, the police to ticket anyone that is beyond the hot top, that's off the hot top totally.
Okay.
But, you know, an argument could be made that is in fact part of the roadway.
But again, we've
never ticketed anyone on the unpaved portion.
Okay, because I have a subdivision down in Biddeford and Saco, and you consider 30 feet the whole road, and so I was wondering, are you talking actually the hot top or the actual shoulder and or the sidewalk if it pertains? Is there any provision for sidewalk along there?
There is no provision for a sidewalk. The other part of the part that's enforced is the pavement in the parking.
All right, thanks.
Thank you, sir. Other comments on this item? Seeing none, I will close this portion of the public hearing. And at this point, I would like to ask for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, a question, please.
Surely.
The word southwesterly is stricken. Thank you. We had a discussion about this previously. Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve the two amendments to Section 13-2-2Q regarding no parking at any time. Section 4, that there be no parking on either side of Shore Road northerly from Route 77 to the northerly property line of 1226 Shore Road. And Section 13, that there be no parking at any time on the driveway connecting the town hall lot with Shore Road.
Second motion.
I have a motion, and then we have a second. Is there discussion on this particular item? Hearing none, all those who are in favor. you very much. The vote passes 7-0. The next of our public hearings this evening is involving dog impoundment fees. This is item number 49, to consider amending the dog ordinance to increase dog impoundment fees and take any necessary action. I will defer to our chair of the ordinance committee, Councilor Cogsell.
Yes, this is under section 7-1-10, where we fees and boarding charges. Any dog impounded here under may be reclaimed upon payment to the town through the Cape Elizabeth Police Department of an impoundment fee of $10 for each dog, except upon the second impoundment, the same dog, the fee shall be $30, and upon the third and all subsequent impoundments of the same dog, the fee shall be $50. And then it continues with the language that is already in the ordinance.
Thank you very much. I would now like to open the public hearing on item number 49. Are there those in the audience who wish to speak to this issue? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and ask for a motion at this time.
Mr. Chairman?
Please.
I move that we accept the change in the impoundment fees for under section 7-1-10 as presented.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. Unanimous vote. The next public hearing is item number 50, involving alarm system registration fees. This is to consider amending the Code of Ordinances to provide for an annual $25 alarm registration fee and take any necessary action. I will again defer to the chair of the Ordinance Committee, Councilor Cogsell.
Under section 8-4-6, we have the addition of the line at the bottom. Alarm systems not connected to the center shall also pay a $25 annual registration fee to the town. It shall be collected in the same manner as service fees for alarm systems connected to the center.
Thank you. Thank you, Councillor. I will now open the public hearing to the audience. Any particular comments? Any individuals wish to speak to this item? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and ask for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve section 8-4-6 as presented this evening.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you. I have a motion and a second. Is there further discussion on this issue? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a procedural question. When would, if this is approved this evening, when would the fees be due, and how are people going to be notified, and what amount is going to be due?
Yeah. It would go, the ordinance itself, the language will not go into effect until 30 days from now. Subsequent to that point, the police department will send out notices to all those with alarm systems of the fee and give them a reasonable period within which to pay it. My guess it would be probably about 45 days. You know, if we send it out in mid-month, we'll probably have it the first of, not the next month, but the next month succeeding.
And it will be the full $25?
That's correct, and it'll be billed annually from that date, from then on.
Good. Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes, a question for the manager. On this alarm system's not connected to the station, what you're thinking of is these alarms that go to another central area and then they call the station?
That's right, and then the police officers respond.
What about the alarm systems that just have an outside audible alarm bell? Are they included in this deal?
No, they're not.
So they have to be connected to a central area where the cable is with or another company is like.
Yeah, I didn't bring the whole ordinance with me this evening, but they have to meet the definition of alarm system as is in the ordinance.
Well, I know there's some that have a outside audible alarm, and sometimes they don't go by telephone to any other area. I was just wondering what you're thinking was there, if it was after those.
Be only those that meet the definition.
Okay.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. 7-0 vote. Public hearing item number 51 involving construction signs. To consider amending the sign ordinance to provide for construction signs and take any necessary action. Again, Councilor Cogsell.
Yes, we recommend adding a new section M to section 21-2-1, signs allowed in all zones without a permit. It would read, one temporary construction sign attached or freestanding, not to exceed 6 square feet per exposed face, may be erected at any construction site for which there is an approved building permit. Home improvements not requiring a permit, such as painting, siding, and landscaping, may also have one temporary sign attached or freestanding, not to exceed 6 square feet per exposed face. All construction and home improvement signs shall be placed not more than 48 hours before the start of the project and removed within 48 hours of the completion of the project. We felt it was necessary to add this section because in the new sign ordinance, we did not deal with these temporary construction signs.
Thank you very much. I would now open this item to the public in our audience this evening. Does anyone wish to address this particular item, item number 51? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and call for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the addition to section 21-2-1, subsection M for signs.
Second the motion.
I have a motion and a second. Is there further discussion? Seeing none, Councilor Gordon.
A comment to the manager, please. The construction signs for a blasting area is handled in what way?
Those are under the safety section sign of the sign ordinance. Those are specifically allowed.
Regardless whether on the street or off the street?
That's correct.
Blasting?
That's correct.
Okay.
Other discussion or comments? All those in favor of the motion? Thank you very much. 7-0 vote. Item number 52, again a public hearing involving submeters and wells. This is to consider a proposed amendment to the sewer ordinance which would require properties on public sewer with wells to have a submeter installed and take any necessary action. Again, Councilor Cogsell.
Yes, we have discovered that there are two or three homes receiving sewer service that do not have public supply of water. And we also have realized that the Portland Water District has changed its policy whereby they will do sewer billing for non-water users if there is a submeter. So therefore, the town manager has asked us to create under section 15-1-11, sewer service charges, subsection F, the town shall require any property with a non-public water supply to install a Portland Water District approved submeter to measure the amount of water used on the property. The submeter shall be purchased and installed at the expense of the property owner. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. I would open the public hearing now to those in the audience. Is there anyone who would wish to address this particular issue? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and call for motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the adoption of section 15-1-11, subsection F.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there discussion on this item? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Our final public hearing for this evening is item number 53, 1231 Shore Road. This item is to consider judging whether or not the property located at 1231 Shore Road, known as the Scout House in parentheses, is a nuisance and or dangerous structure and take any necessary action. At this particular time, I will defer to our town manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Last month, the town council set a public hearing on whether or not, judging whether or not this building is dangerous. Subsequently, a title search was done on the property by the town attorney's office. We notified the property owner as well as two parties in interest as of July 9th that you were going to be holding the public hearing this evening. The building inspector, the fire chief, the police chief, the code enforcement administrator, and myself visited the property this morning, and the building inspector is here to provide you an update on the review of the property and provide other information relative to the proceedings before you.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Mr. McVain, would you be kind enough to come to the podium and give us the update the town manager just referred to?
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to pass out some pictures that were taken this afternoon. The building at 1231 Shore Road has generated a number of complaints over the years. Most of the complaints were that it was unsightly, not properly secured, etc. And the owners of the property would, upon notice or a phone call, would take care of that situation. Initially, I wasn't willing to request that this building be considered an unsafe structure because I did not feel that that was the case back in 85 and 86 when I first started inspecting the building. However, over the years, the weathering of the building has resulted in a number of things taking place, such as the roof has sagged in several locations, at least several inches, especially around the chimney. The front portion of the building is on a foundation, and the back part of the building is on a slab. And when you have these two types of structures connected, you get a lot of moving as a result of frost in the ground. This has also resulted in the building now being out of plumb, along with the live load on the roof shifting, what have you. If you look at the building, the exterior walls are out of plumb, which is an indication that it's not withstanding the load that it needs to in order to maintain its integrity. Also, it's a health hazard in that should we ever have a fire there, generally the fire department, the first people on the scene, if warranted, if there was, let's say, a door open or boards removed, they would most likely do a primary search in that they would send people into the building. Should these firefighters go in the front door, they're going to take two steps and be in the basement. And I think that in itself is a direct hazard that would warrant this building being removed. Also, although a separate issue, the property on inspection today, the cesspool has been damaged so that what we have now is a pit probably 6 feet deep, maybe 8 feet wide. Although it hasn't been used for a number of years, it is an open pit. It is a place for, it is a place for an accident waiting to happen. Also, the property has an underground tank, and the tank, from what I've been able to determine, is not registered, nor do I believe it could be registered because there is no heating system, and at best, one would have to consider this to be an abandoned tank. The roof, the shingles are, for the most part, missing, and the rafters have been subject to the weather, the rain, what have you. And I also believe that you have a copy of a memo to me from Mr. Daigle, which indicates that back in 87, the building was considered to be 70% of, lost 70% of its value in terms of market value. It's exceeded the 50% that the code addresses in terms of updating buildings. In other words, if a building has depreciated to a point of more than 50%, the code requires you to correct the deficiencies in accordance or as you would a new structure. You would have to bring this entire building up to present codes, even though it's existing, if the value of the building exceeds 50% of the loss of value. And in this case, I think we have a combined loss of about 70%. Can I answer any questions?
Yes, Mr. McFain. We do not have that document. I actually have a copy right here, and I'll pass it to my right, and then I'll bring it back and pass it over to my left. The depreciation is about actually 72%, as stated on the document. I have just one question, Mr. McFain. I'm sure most of us have been over to take a peek into the building. There has been some recent work over the last couple of days on the building. In your professional opinion, has that recent work changed anything with respect to the issue this evening, as far as you're concerned?
Actually, I think that it's made things a little worse in that the building is not a guarded building. There are broken windows, and it's someone could get access to the building a lot easier now that the exterior boards have been removed. I would not bring this type of request to a council based on appearance. Initially, when I started first receiving complaints, that was the complaint. It's an eyesore. I mean, I used to hear it all the time. But I was not willing, was it warranted at that time, to come forward with it.
Thank you. Please ask my fellow counselors if they have questions or need for further clarification with respect to this item, as long as our Mr. McVain is at the podium. Councilman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. McVain, are you aware of any structural improvements that have been made to that building within the last month or two?
I have, no. I have requested in a letter recently sent that the owner, if he disagreed with my findings, for him to provide me a document stating what would be needed to bring this building in compliance with the Boca Code. I've also met with the owner on a number of occasions and have given him every opportunity to come forward with a plan or a document indicating that the building was structurally sound, and to date I have not received any of those documents, any documents.
So no permits have been taken out for any?
No permits have been taken out for
work of that nature.
That's right.
I appreciate your pointing out that the appearance is not the basis for your judgment this evening, and I thank you.
Well,
further questions? Thank you, Mr. McVain.
Thank you.
I would now like to open this particular item to the public with respect to the fact that it is a public hearing. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak to item number 53? Please come right down.
Steve Vigilio. I hope to avoid a confrontation over this, because I really think this is getting a little blown out of proportion. It started, I guess, at your last meeting, some of the comments made here. Let me address that in a little while. But basically, I need to just talk. You know, Ernie and I have always gotten along. And as far as this change all of a sudden here, let me document this a little bit. In the past, Mr. McGovern mentioned in the last meeting that you had sent several notices to me back in 1990 and in 1991, and just kind of left it at that, like as if I was in non-compliance here. But every time I received a notice, I either came in and responded personally to Ernie or by phone. I boarded the back because there was vandals supposedly going through there. And then at another date, which I have documentation here, first notice was that I have here is March 30th. I am notifying you that this building is deemed unsafe. I am requesting that the building be secured by boarding of all openings immediately. In the event that this is not secured, I will have no recourse but to forward this matter to the town council. I complied with that, and on the 9th, I told Ernie, if the economy picks up, I'll go ahead with the developmental plans and do some of the building. I have some plans I put on hold of building several offices and/or shops in the year because I have the land next door, but the economy has spoken otherwise, and I just, at this time, don't want to get into that, okay? So I said I'll probably try to do something next year, which is, brings us to this year. I met with him again on the 17th of April, and we discussed the situation. You know, what are we going to do? Should we tear it down? Should we do this? Should we do that? The irony is, a few years ago, I would have torn it down. But now I don't want to, and I'll tell you why. Because of several factors here. One, my dad used to putt around on that, and out of respect for him, I want to keep this building, and I'll bring it back to code. The other is that a lot of the girls that have come through our town, used to have the Girl Scout meetings there. Mrs. Murray used to, you know, she's been over there with her anniversary parties, what have you. There's a lot of significance there, and just to look at this as a junky old building, let's get it out of the way, I just find that kind of harsh. And basically, if you know, these factors have tended to change my mind. I think I can I know I can rebuild this building, and I have some documentation on that, that it's not structurally beyond repair here. And I have a letter here saying that, you know, thank you for meeting with me on April 17th, 1991. And so actually, I have complied. It's not, you know, I think you were, whether it was, you know, I think it was unintentional that basically, you know, I just kind of just shrugged my shoulders and said, the heck with it. I have been addressing this issue. In fact, Mr. Murray told me after I boarded it up, I guess some vandals used to sleep in there. They ran across the street, started hanging out in his equipment. You know, so I'd like to clear that point up that I have complied, and I am complying, but I only have so much time to do what I can. Now, there was two issues here, and it seems like we've lost one of them now, that it's an eyesore, and also a dilapidated and unsafe structure. It appears now all of a sudden it's not an eyesore because I've cleaned up the front of it, and I've replaced almost every pane of glass. I ran out of the upper window, so there's three broken windows left out of probably 25 that I've replaced. Pardon me? Get to that, ma'am. So basically, I am working on that, and I am also addressing the structural aspects of the building. Cosmetically, I've tried to remove this eyesore. I know there seems to be a lot of attention in this area all of a sudden because of the new community center, and we're focusing on this. And I agree with you. You know, this wouldn't be confused with the Hotel Frontenac or Trump Plaza by any means, but, you know, and I've taken it one step at a time. So I'm cosmetically, I'm not painting this building because I think it's fallen down. I mean, that'd be stupid. It just doesn't make sense. I've had three people look at this, two engineers and a local carpenter, and they're all in agreement that the structural problems here are minimal. And I'll document that in a few minutes. I don't want to, you know, get into, you know, different viewpoints here because I know you all have different viewpoints, and I think I'll just pass on that. And a couple colleagues of mine told me this, that, and the other about prejudging things like this, that you're wasting your time going here. But I really don't think I am. I really am going to appeal to each and every one of you and your intelligence that you make the correct decision here because it's not going to end here tonight one way or the other. I'm going to rebuild this building, and I'm going to bring it up to code with or without your help here. It's because I really believe that it'd be a disservice to this town to just blow this thing away and not, you know, give it a fair shake. There's historical significance. If I'm sure some of you have read this book, Collections from Cape Elizabeth. There's page 123, there's a little excerpt about the Scout House and the different activities and the Girl Scout meeting, etc. I think you're going to peel a piece of Cape Elizabeth history away by running the bulldozer through that place. My game plan here is this, okay? I'm going to, you know, I'm going to continue with the cosmetic aspects of this, and next week I've already bought quite a few different 2x8 joists to shore up, and actually I'm going to rebuild the floor in there. I don't want to sit here and say this isn't true or this, but if you looked in the window, you'll see that in the first few feet, you're not going to fall into the cellar. There's actually a piano sitting there. I'm not sure how much an average piano weighs, but if it's holding that piano up, it'll hold you all up. And all we're looking at is on the far end of the right structure, about 120 inches of floor that I've straightened out and cleared out. Part of this floor was broken a few years ago by vandals, and then we had a water leak in there, and my nephew got in there. We were going to just tear, got the building, like I said, a few years ago. Now, with the broken windows, there was rainwater getting in there, and the front part leaks, and it caused, you know, further deterioration in that corner. But the rest of that is perfectly safe. I've been in there, and different two engineers have been in there, and a local carpenter has been in there, and they're all in agreement that it's premature to bury this place, and it can be easily brought back into a sound and viable structure. As far as that, I think, to be honest with you, the roof, which surprised me, we went up on the roof, and where the shingles are so bad on the front half of the front part of the building, I really expected a lot of rot up there. There's like one board up there that's gray that might need to be replaced. And the rest of it is just a matter of reshingling that. The front half of the front leaks, but the back side of the front doesn't. The whole back doesn't even leak, except for right by the chimney, because whoever put the chimney in there they just cut the rafters and they didn't put a header in there, so basically it sags there. This is an area probably that Ernie alluded to. And all you have to do is just cut that section out and put a header in there. And those two rafters that come down from that chimney, they are a little bit worn. Replace those rafters and you've got no problems. As far as the back of it bowing, that's been like that for years. But it has very strong collar ties. I don't know if you're familiar with that. They're huge, huge ties across the building. That building isn't going to go anywhere. You can sit there and George Flaherty can bring a snow dump pile from Portland out there and put on that roof, and it's not going to give. But that will hold. There's an area where it buckled a little bit on the side, and there's a dip in the roof, but that's due to the fact that part of the sill was rotted from the same area where this header was in place, so the water had to drain out. And this is just, these repairs can be made and can be brought back, can bring this building back. As far as the fire hazard, the boarding, was the idea of the town to keep people out of there, and I guess it did in the back. I haven't taken the boards off the back, but in the meantime, while I'm working on this, I can leave keys with the fire department here if they have a problem with that, because, you know, to get in this thing. As far as the cesspool, I wasn't familiar with that, and the drainage tank, I just realized that you had to register that last week. I was talking with Mr. Murray about that. But these are things that can be done, and there's no problem on my part to do this. I think Mr. Murray's a great guy. I guess he's had some problems with his dirt pile over there and his equipment and stuff, but I think he's, I like to tip my hat to him. The guy seems like a fair-minded individual, and people like the Murrays have, I think, done a lot for this town. This town's is a strong town because of people like that. And I would like to thank him for any information. I would like to thank him for helping clear that front out. As far as an opportunity on this, most of the requests from this town have been of defensive nature. Put it out. Somebody's in there, board it up. Up until just recently, there's been a complete reversal here. I don't know whether this coincides with that community center or just what. But now, all of a sudden, let's get rid of it. And I've just been, notified of this just in the last couple, 3 months here. And I have to
things take time. I have to have a little bit of time to address that. But like I said, I have a plan to do that, to address all these things. Let me just stop for a second. And do you have like a report or something on all of an engineering report on this building? No? Well, I do. Okay. East Harbor Development Group, notarized. And this is an excellent group out of the Biddeford Saco area. And they maintain tremendous business throughout this recession because they do quality work. And they take old buildings that have been, you know, dropped over the side, like we can't do anything, and they fix them. And this is from one of their men, Lester Barron. It says, to whom, may I read this to you? To whom it may concern. My findings of structural defects about 31 Shore Road are minimal defects consisting of 10 feet of sill in the back right corner of the main building. Now that's that front building. As you look at it, as you stand in the front, that's that area where, if you've peeked in there, I squared that off. I've cleaned all the broken wood out of there and the nails and squared that right off. That's that sill we're talking about. The rest of them are in good shape. I'm going to replace the whole floor anyways because I have a lot of people interested in getting into this place, but I'll get to that in a minute. Also, two rafters and adjoining boards connecting the chimney. I've already alluded to that. That's due to that, you know, the construction where the chimney was placed, not, you know, placing a header in there. Okay, the left front of adjoining building needs 6 feet of sill. This is that area. You have your front here and the back, which bowed a little bit. This is where I was telling you about those rafters. When the rain came down, it had to move its way out. It seeks its lowest point. So we have a little bit of rot there. Of secondary nature, is 10 feet of the right end needs to be rejoiced and replywood. That's that hole, but like I said, I'm redoing the whole floor. And there's a comment here about the front roof of the main building needs to be re-roofed. Okay, I'll pass that around with you. It's notarized in the back of the life. Okay. And I had Bob Swift Engineering in Norway, Maine, has looked at it too, and will be, you know, forwarding a report on that if you would like. I have another report from Larry Skillens. I'm sure some of you know Larry. He's a builder in this town. And basically the same thing. This building located Shore Road, which is now used to be the Girl Scout House and is now owned by Stephen Bagilio, has been checked out for structural problems. But problems were found can easily be solved to meet requirements. The main front building of the Scout House is on a good foundation. The wooden floor inside, a portion has to be replaced. Basically goes pretty much the same thing about the joists and the plywood, etc. Okay, the main carrying beams and the lilac columns were checked out and they'll meet structural requirements. The entire back building of the Scout House was checked, and he has a plan here to jack up the walls where there's some rotted sill so you can replace the sill, probably put a new footing in, and using a come along can make these walls plumb again. Section of the cement floor of the outer ridge that is either settled or broke off will be replaced. These repairs should meet all structures. Okay, that's not, he didn't sign that, but I can easily have him put that on a letterhead for you if we need to go that far. So what I'm saying here is I didn't come here to fight with you or to, I've got four children home, I've got to go home and put to bed. I think we need to, you know, not be impulsive in this. If you feel that you can't, or I feel that maybe if you want to see whether or not I come along with some repairs on this, table this thing for now, and I'll get your steps in, okay, along with everything else, and see for yourself. I'm going to fix this up. I've tabled my plans of building anything in there. I'm going to take this building, and I'm going to bring it back to Vitality. I have a lot of people. Just Sunday, I was out there doing some work on that, and I had several people. One wanted to open a bike shop, another an antique shop, another a child care, another a woodworking shop, and yet another one today mentioned something about putting a gift shop. It's got a lot of potential. It'd be cute. I even colored it Cape Colors, it's, you know, the maroon and the white. Give it a chance. It's not that bad. I'll be willing to work with Ernie on this and show him the improvements, and I'll bring that thing up to code. It's that simple. Let's not, you know, make a mistake. You know, I'm not putting this in the same scenario as Union Station or something, but it's a piece of cake, Elizabeth, that I think we should keep it going, and let me continue to restore this. And I'll have that thing rented out and something in there within probably 90 days. I'll have it all up to code. So we won't have to worry about it being abandoned and the fire department, et cetera. In the meantime, like I said, I'll be glad to leave the key with the fire department. But I'll be over there probably every day. You know, there's got some of these other areas on hold down in Biddeford Saco, and I'll give this my fullest to restore this, because basically I think it deserves that chance. Okay, I guess if there's any questions, if you'd like to see for yourself, or have any other questions or comments, I'll address them right now.
I have just one quick one, Mr. Vigilio. The report by Lester Barron doesn't have the same address. It's at 1233 Shore Road.
I wasn't sure just what that place was. It was 1231 or 1233, so there's a mailbox that was actually 1231, and then the next house was 1235, so I just told him it was 12, you know, put down 1233. Okay.
We're talking about the same building, though.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
It perhaps would be helpful at this point, if counselors do have questions during the public hearing, and I can certainly then ask for additional input from the audience. At this time, are there questions for Mr. Vigilio as he is at the podium right now for us? Counselor Jordan.
Yes, Oakland Valley didn't sign it, I can't find it.
Well, it's just like a rough draft. That's what I said. Yeah. If you want that official, he'll gladly put that on.
I know Larry well, since he's a minister.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised his name isn't on there.
Right. Well, he can stop in, and like I said, and he'll put that on his letterhead, what have you. I just told him, just jot down comments. I didn't ask for an actual official report from him. So.
I have a couple of three questions, if I may, Mr. Chairman, just to kick the thing off. How long do you feel it would take you? I heard you mention 90 days to rebuild that and get the structure
done. We're going to be working on the structural aspect of that within 2 weeks. I have a Jimmy Fund tournament I'm running, and once I get by that, then I'll be free. I'll be able to get up here, and the East Harbor will be able to get up here. So within 2 weeks, we'll start, and like I said, we'll get the permits and work with Ernie on that.
Do you have a game plan, as I might call it, or just your procedures on how you're going to proceed?
Well, first thing I'm going to do is fix that front roof, because there's no sense of doing anything else with it leaking like that, and replace that, probably that one board that I mentioned to you that was a little worn, and fix, you know, the roof by the chimney, put a head in there. And once we secure those two areas, then we've stopped any leaks from the roof. And then I'll work on the floor. We should be able to do that floor without too much problem, because the main beam's in fine shape, and it'd be a matter of putting 2x8 10-footers on either side, and should be able to do that pretty quick. So once we do that, the walls will plumb in the front, and then we'll work on the back part as far as plumbing the walls there. And we'll just rewire it. I'm not going to touch any of the old wires or anything like that. And also plumbing.
Thank you.
Basically, what you have here is kind of like, reminds me of an old bureau that my sons and I were out the dump one time. It was black and orange and yellow. We would bring some wood out there. And someone had thrown it away. And it was all cracked, and really it was kind of unsightly. And I had just built them a little clubhouse, and I said, well, I'll get it for you guys. Well, I had to make a trade with them, because after I got it home and stripped it and cleaned it all up, there was nothing wrong with it. It was pure oak. And I had it appraised, just a friend of mine, Ethel Bailey's, and it was appraised at $130.
that was something they were just going to throw away. You know, I just don't, sometimes appearances and minimal problems, like I said, you know, you can prejudge some, but you've got to back yourself up and say, well, wait a minute here. You know, am I doing the right thing?
Are there other questions for Dr. Virgilio?
So I guess what I'm...
Counselor Amaro?
You said you could start this work in 2 weeks.
Yes, ma'am.
When could you have that building meeting all of the codes?
Like I said, within 90 days. Probably sooner than that. You know, there's, like I said, there's a lot of interest. I've had a lot of, like you've had a lot of calls complaining about how unsightly it is and everything, or Ernie has. I've had a lot of calls from people wanting to buy it and lease it, and I just was kind of holding here to, because I had a greater plan there, but I don't see any immediate relief in the economy in the New England area, so I'm going to take and just and fix this place up, do what I have to do. And like I said, these three individuals, Larry, Swift, and Lester, have all in accordance that it wouldn't take that much to bring that back to code. You can see just what a little bit of paint and, you know, just replaces some of the windows does just for the cosmetic aspects of it. You know, and just cleaning up the front and what have you. These guys are all very skilled in their abilities, and I think we'll do a nice, strong, neat, and precise job.
Counselor Cogsell.
Yes, Mr. Virgilio, if you were to restore this building and have it meet all codes within 90 days, would that also include the removal of the septic, the cesspool, and that underground tank? Because those are
right, see,
hazardous,
I just,
and that's one of our primary concerns is the hazard.
I agree with you. I was going to get to that anyways. Mr. Murray mentioned that to me, and I believe you have to register that in Augusta or something. He's going to, when he gets back from his trip west, of the Midwest, we're going to discuss that and take care of that.
I have a question really of Mr. McVeigh. If this would be appropriate, sure, I wait until later.
Well, it is in the public hearing portion right now. Perhaps it would be convenient if Mr. McVeigh could take the question as long as it's being asked.
Mr. McVeigh, has a deadline passed for registration of underground tanks? And wasn't there an age restriction as far as their...
Both, yes. Also, this is an abandoned tank. I doubt seriously they would register it. Also, there's no heating system.
So even with going through the red tape of trying to register this, it probably might take longer than this 90 days.
I seriously doubt that he could register it. And okay. It would probably take more than the 90 days. The cleanest thing to do, obviously, is remove it.
And if this was a cesspool that was there, not a full septic
system?
It
was a cesspool, which does not have a septic tank. All the effluent solids dump into one pit. And that is an open pit at this time.
So at the moment, we're not sure whether or not that would pass any kind of a soils test, or is it eligible for the sewer?
I believe it's eligible for the sewer. And it is a violation of the Maine State Plumbing Code. Did notice it today, and I will be sending a notice of violation out on that.
And my other question is, if this building were torn down, would he be able to reconstruct another building in that same footprint?
We would honor the same footprint for a period of 1 year. And any use that it would be proposed for that property would require site plan review by the planning board.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McVeigh. Please, Mr. Virgilio.
I just had a question for Ernie. As far as the violation of, could you just explain that to me?
Yes, anytime you abandon a septic system, you're required by state statute to fill it, whether it be a tank, a cesspool, generally it's one or the other. And in this case, we have an open cesspool by state statute is required to be filled once abandoned, and I consider this to be abandoned, seeing there's no plumbing in the building, no water to the building.
Thank you. want some concluding comments, Mr. Virgilio?
I still was wondering about that. As far as filling this, you just basically backfill this, or do you have to, you know, with a certain type of stone, or 3/8 stone, or what? See, this is news to me. I wasn't aware of it.
The code would require that it be backfilled with clean fill. Basically, aggregates of stone up to 3-inch or sand.
Thank you very much, Mr. McFain. What I don't want to have is a back and forth for the for a while. We can get that information later.
Okay. One last comment. When the sewer was put in that area, I had a stub put in. I don't plan to, you know, have to have the soil tested using a septic system or anything and hook into the sewer. Okay. I think that answers your question. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Are there others in the audience that would like to address this particular issue as the public hearing is open? Seeing none, I will close this portion of the public hearing and initiate a call for discussion from my fellow councilors on the issue.
Mr. Chairman.
Please, Mr. Chaplin.
No matter how this vote finally goes, I for one, Councilor, want everyone to know that I'm very uncomfortable. I don't like what I've been hearing. I think that there's been plenty of notice given and everything that I can read here for some work to be done there before the last 3 days or the last 2 weeks. I think it's gone too far. I can't understand any owner of any property that's notified by the town that corrections have to be made that lets it go to a public hearing. I don't think that that's the way to do business. I don't want to be put in the position as a councilor that I have to, from what I've heard tonight, make a good decision on this. I'm very uncomfortable.
Further discussion. Councilor Jordan?
I kind of have the same feeling that Aaron has there as far as having it go right up to a public hearing kind of bothers me, because I think I know the history of the building as well as everybody in this room. And I've known it many times in years past. And can't understand why that if somebody was going to fix it up, why it hadn't been done. And so it had been done before they set a public hearing. Now, I was really a very reasonable person, I always felt. And if I could see that within 3 months the thing would be in any shape, I think I would go out on a limb and ask for that, but I don't know, is it all that can be done in that length of time? And this is a part that bothers me. So I don't know, right at this point, just how I'm going on the Senate.
Councilor Cogsell.
I too feel somewhat uncomfortable that a structure that is of such historic significance to Cape Elizabeth, which is one of its selling points to retain it tonight, is only just coming to the forefront now. And if the historic significance was of that much importance, that something would have been done through the past few years.
Thank you for your comments. Councillor McLaughlin.
Water on the side. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I spoke when Mr. McFain was at the podium, I had heard this comment earlier from him today and have been keeping it in mind during the course of this evening's discussion when I took my own tour at the end of the afternoon around the building, that you can't judge the building by its appearance. I think what we have seen in the last couple of weeks is improvements to the appearance of the building. From my limited knowledge about this kind of structure, I'm extremely concerned about the safety of it. There is a hole in the floor
in the front. And it's not just a hole that just I by myself would fall through. If the bunch of us went in there, we'd all fall down in that hole together. Right now, I did try the doors on the building. The doors were secure. I found a way a small child or an animal can get into that building. I'm not going to tell you where it is because I don't want the small children, who hopefully are in bed by now, trying it. There could be an animal caught in there tonight. There could be a skunk in there. There could be lots of noise, somebody asking, saying that there's something wrong in there, one of our police officers going in there, getting hurt because it's not a safe structure. I didn't hear anything tonight addressing the foundation of that building. Mr. McVane spoke about the two different types of foundations, one a slab and one a, what's the other one? A full foundation. You're going to continue to have structural problems, I believe, if you continue to have two different kinds of foundations, no matter how much plumbing you do to the supports there. Also being presented is the fact that this would have to go through planning board review to put in some of the uses that we've heard discussed tonight. If you think that's going to happen in 3 months, I think you're sorely mistaken.
Thank you. Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Councilor Grumman. I'm uncomfortable, too, with the whole hoopla here for a lot of different reasons. I think that if you drew a comparison to another building that we, actually two buildings that were voted to be condemned by the town, comparing those with this one, there's no comparison. The one on Ocean House Road down Route 77 across from Papudic, I walked around that one, the foundation was cracked. That was very dangerous. And that one, and the owner didn't even stick up for his rights on that one. He agreed that it was awful and it should be condemned, as did the one on, I believe it was Sawyer Road at the 90-degree turn there. That was a foundation that had to be backfilled because that was a hazard. I think here with Mr. Vigilio, if he's making an earnest step, I don't care what point it is, whether it came to a public hearing or not, now's the time we put the test to him and say, if there's any way we can continue this public hearing until, you know, another 30 days, giving him time to come up with estimates for renovations, to bring it up to code as the code enforcement officer said it had to be, according to BOCA code 120-4, I guess, which said that any building that has gone past 50% of its value, depreciated past 50%, has to be brought up completely to current day codes. I think if those estimates are provided and Mr. Vigilio is willing to bond that work, that it doesn't matter site plan approval or not, the building, no matter what it's used for, still has to be brought up to code. And I don't think we're asking him to make it usable in 90 days as far as shops are going to move in there. But if it's brought up to code and that's willing to be bonded, I think that that's something that should be entertained before it's just demolished. And then he's got to go through the whole review as far as building a new building on that site.
Thank you. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One concern I have with that suggestion, Councilor Pearson, is being fairly well acquainted with the difficulties a lot of people are having in obtaining bond guarantees lately. I'm not sure that we can sit here and assume that Dr. Vigilio can receive and present to the town the proper bond documents.
Thank you.
I would entertain a motion at this particular time, seeing that the discussion has ended. Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, I'll kick off a motion to see how far we go. And to get things moving, that kind of feels that bothers a lot of people. Bothers people in the council just which way to go and bulldoze that down, and they feel that it was a mistake. So I'll make a motion that we give 30 days to come back to the town of Cape Elizabeth with a plan in writing and certificates from contractors saying when they would start and what they would do to bring that building up to code and an estimate of the cost of building it.
Second. We have a motion and we have a second. Discussion. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councilor Jordan, how are you going to guarantee that that work will actually get done? What do you have information, or are you going to require information about financial capacity? I hear a lot of plans and a lot of reports, and I've seen painting completed and some of the grounds cleared up. That's a very different financial kind of financial commitment.
I would think if a contractor was going to give him an estimate on when they would do their work and how much it would cost, it seems to me that they would feel that the bucks are there to be able to do it. They wouldn't waste their time in giving them the figures. How I can put into a motion to guarantee the bucks are there to do the project, I don't quite know how to put it. If you want to add an amendment to my motion, I'll accept it happily.
I think you're misjudging how hungry the contractors are these days. I think they will give you an estimate without knowing the bucks are there.
Well, we have a motion, we have a second. Is there any other discussion on this particular motion? Mr. Manager.
I just had a question for Councilor Jordan as to intent. Contractors will write what they want to get work. Did you have more in mind that perhaps, I think the building inspector, in the past, whenever there's been a real problem, has always requested a report from a structural engineer. We've not simply relied on a building contractor. And, I think that the history of the school department and some of their problems have indicated, the importance of having a structural engineer as opposed to just a contractor who wants some work.
Don't get me into the portables yet. It's the next item on the agenda. And it feels that all new buildings in the town are equally as bad shape as a scouting house, as I understand the reports.
Councilor Cogsell.
I feel very concerned about not having guaranteed financial backing. Because this can just go on for another few years and keep saying this is going to happen to have an extension. I think if the council voted to give Mr. Virgilio time to get the plans and the contracts and everything else, that we would need a guarantee of the financing. And that wouldn't be possible, I don't think, in 30 days.
Thank you. Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Councilor Crown. Would it be possible to amend Councilor Jordan's motion that said estimates and projected timelines for work also be accompanied by an engineer's report certified stating the structural integrity and that improvements planned will meet those code requirements and integrity points, and as well not necessarily a financial bond, but is a letter of commitment from a bank, essentially the same thing, dedicated to certain projects. I know a bond can't be established, if you will, going through a bond process, but I'm sure that a financial commitment from a bank, either based on a home equity loan or whatever, that said funds are to be dedicated for such and such, I think are a step in the right direction. And then after 30 days, if this public hearing continues to that point, if nothing's been done in good faith, then it can be right back to where we are and we can have a vote on the original matter before us.
You've offered an amendment. Do I hear a second?
I'll second that.
The amendment's been seconded. Could you, for the benefit of the council, read the amendment?
This would amend Councilor Jordan's motion that said estimates and projected time would accompany an engineer's report stating that the work will meet code requirements, and also required a letter of commitment from a bank for the project.
Is the amendment acceptable to the original motion, Councilor Jordan?
Yes, sir.
We have an amendment at the present time and a second. Councilor Cogson.
I just have a question. If anyone has even a range of how many dollars we're talking about, how much would this cost, roughly? Does anyone have a sliding scale? Mr. Virgilio? You have been involved in other developments. Do you have some idea?
Mr. Virgilio, I would just ask if you would please limit your comments to under 3 minutes.
Okay. Be honest with you, I wouldn't be able to give you a dollar figure tonight, but I would be able to have that for you, no problem, within 30 days, and a letter of commitment.
Thank you. We have an amendment and a second at the present time. Is there discussion on the amendment and the second? I have a show of hands, all those in favor of the amendment. All those opposed. Okay. The amendment is defeated by a vote of 4-3. We have the original motion on the floor and a second. Is there further discussion on the original motion? For our benefit, would the town clerk read the original motion?
It was moved and seconded to give the owner 30 days to obtain a plan in writing, plus certificates from contractors, including estimates of cost and time, to be reported back to the town council.
Thank you. Is there further discussion on the original motion? May I have a hand vote on the motion? All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay, the vote is defeated. The motion is defeated by a vote of 5-2. We are left with the need for a further motion. I will entertain a motion.
You tell me how to make this motion. I'll try to make it. But I would like to see us extend the public hearing. Is that possible, Mr. Manager, for 30 days? Not make a decision tonight. Let this gentleman prove to us what's going to be done rather than us sitting back here giving him ultimatums. I want the ultimatums to be on the other side.
You'd like to continue the public hearing?
Yes. And if he doesn't come back in 30 days with something that I can buy and chew and swallow, I'm going to vote no right off. So it's up to him. I think this thing has gone altogether too long. I think he needs an ultimatum. Period. And if he comes back with something we can work on, fine. If he doesn't, he's all done.
Hey, to answer your question, if the council could continue the
yes.
public hearing.
Can we?
Yes.
Thank you. Second. I would make a motion then that this particular part of tonight's public hearing be extended for 30 days. And at the end of 30 days, Mr. Virgilio knows what he has to do, and we'll be ready to receive him again.
The next council
meeting.
At the next council meeting, I think you should do.
All right, I'm sorry. At the next council meeting, which will be September?
9th.
The 9th. And then he can show intent that way, can he, Mr. Manager?
That would be a judgment of the council whether or not he showed intent.
Thank you.
We do have a motion right now, and we do have a second. Is there further discussion on extending the public hearing for approximately a month to our September 1991 monthly town council meeting?
May I just have a question? Information.
Please.
We've already closed the public hearing. Are we really voting to reopen it? We're just having our discussion now. The public hearing itself was closed.
The public hearing was closed.
So would you accept an amendment to have the public hearing reopened at next month's meeting?
I'll second it.
Okay. Thank you for the clarification, Councilor Cogsell. We have a motion and we have a second.
I just have one other comment. The only difference in her dimension and my dimension, as I understand it, I asked for him to come back with certain things, and her motion is, it's up to him what he comes back with. Is that a fair statement? Okay, I'll vote for your motion.
We do have a motion, we have a second. Is there further discussion on reopening the public hearing at the next council meeting in September? All those in favor for this motion? All those opposed? The vote carries 6-1. We will reopen the public hearing at our September 9th, 1991 monthly town council meeting. Okay, that concludes the section of the agenda tonight dealing with public hearings. We will now move to item number 54. This is to consider a request from the Cape Elizabeth School Board to utilize $80,000 in funds remaining from school bond issues for the repair of portable classrooms and take any necessary action. I see both a member of the school board, an esteemed former counselor, and I see the superintendent of the school board. Did you want to present this item in tandem, or have you chosen a speaker? The superintendent, please come down, Dr. Goldman.
I think the timing of my discussion after listening to the item on your agenda just preceding strikes me as being interesting, but it was inadvertent on all of our parts.
We can start a moment.
I'd like to give you a little bit of background. As I understand it, some of you, of course, were on the council that would have made the initial decision on the town council's role in dealing with leased space with schools. But in case anybody here is a little unfamiliar with that, or to clarify my own understanding, I would like to just summarize a few issues. As I understand the background for this, the school department in 1988 came to you with an issue of expanding enrollment and program pressures at the elementary school. Now, and at the same time, or preceding slightly that actual date, the school department was aware that enrollments were climbing and that certain additional programs, some of them state mandated, some of them local choice, had in fact increased pressure on space. Therefore, something had to happen, and a study was commissioned and looked at the possible uses and ways in which the current buildings were being used could be reconfigured. Whatever the exact discussions and whatever the reaction between the school committee or the school board and parent community or responses to some of the suggestions, ultimately the school board made a decision that the most prudent and the short-term situation would be to go to lease space. For those of you who may be unaware with what's been happening in the state, this has been a fairly common phenomenon, not only in this part of the state, but in other parts where we are, as school buildings, having to absorb the children of the baby boom. In some cases, some school districts have closed schools between the baby boom and the baby boom let, sold schools, or had them go for other uses, and therefore there were no elastic spaces. As a matter of fact, here in this town, the schools that were open and available for use for elementary, most notably Cape Cottage School, I believe is now a series of condominiums or apartments or something. Anyway, they are no longer available for school use. This is a problem that has been plaguing school districts in the area and in other fairly populous parts of our state, and I'm sure others. So that it means that something has to happen. Where are you going to go? I understand that some discussion was held about using parts of the high school. I understand that that was not a popular choice with some of the parent community. And I just remind you that a decision was made balancing all those issues to go to lease space. The typical per foot square rental for lease space runs about $12 to $14 on a conservative side. It can, in fact, run more than that. There are two ways in which school districts typically get lease space. Actually, there are three. One, you can go to space that is in your district or in your area that is owned by a private company or perhaps a church and lease it from them. You may lease on usually a three-year lease basis from a prefab organization, or you may deal with a private contractor who builds your portable stick-built on site. All of those yield at least a 12 to 14 charge per square foot as a rule. Some districts have, in fact, gone to the municipality of the district and suggested that the town actually invest in and build suitable portable space or temporary space and turn around and lease it to the school department. The reason for that, of course, is that you're not in business to make money, and therefore you do not have the same kind of pressure on you that a private contractor would have in order to lease out space and make a profit. And that is, of course, the cheapest way to do it. If you look at the space that we are using, covered by the three portable units that we're talking about, it amounts to about, taking a number of factors into consideration, about $5 per square foot. That is, of course, considerably less than what you might have to go to for a private leaser. So that is taking into consideration the general broad view. In my memo to you, I brought you up to date. I think I had mentioned some of these issues to you when I came in earlier this year to talk about what I was discovering about structural problems in a number of building renovation designs that have been going on in the schools. I had been alerted by structural design consultants who has been commissioned by the school department to deal with the analysis of our buildings from a structural point of view, that we had some problems with the portables. The major problem that they were alerting us to is that because they are attached to the school buildings, we have a snowdrift problem, and they simply do not meet current code. We were advised to shovel the roofs. We had one snowstorm which required us to do that, and in doing it, we discovered that it was difficult, it was expensive in the sense of putting people on the roof. We used, in one case, we used our own people. In another case, at the high school, in a similar situation, we used contractors. We attempted to find people who might be in business for themselves, who would have appropriate equipment, who would like to come out and service that whole problem for us. We found nobody interested in doing the portables. We could, in fact, deal with the high school roof we had to shovel off. The portables also have a unique problem for us in the sense that not only do we have the snow load problem, but the buildings themselves are really oversized. And in doing the design work for the repair, structural engineers discovered that they are actually marginally adequate as they sit. Even if they were sitting in the middle of a meadow, they would not necessarily meet total code as far as overstressed walls and so forth. So that we cannot simply say that snow removal would in fact make these buildings totally code appropriate. I did bring this situation to the school committee or the school board. Obviously they're as distressed as I'm sure you are about what feels like putting good money after bad. But the fact of the matter is that we are set up to use these spaces. We did look at the situation of closing one of the portables, the one that is at the end of the so-called D wing in the middle school where we have seventh grade classrooms, and simply transferring those classes to the high school. It would still leave us with two portables that we must use in order to have library media and computer programs at the K-8, both the one at Pond Cove and the one at the middle school, so that simply taking that expedient will not solve our problem. We would still have to go ahead if we were going to use those spaces and continue with some work. It is not exactly cut into thirds. I have asked the contractor, both for the school committee's purposes and certainly if any of you are interested for your purposes, to find exactly what each building would cost. But it, in a third, to say we could close one and chop the cost in thirds is perhaps not quite accurate. I think the one that might be closed and we could transfer the kids would be a little more than a third. At any rate, we would still be forced to proceed with a shoring up project. I think that that is the general overview. My memo did cover those issues as well as some others. I clearly am here to answer questions. I have to say, in all honesty, that the board did not find it possible to come up with a unanimous vote on this. Nevertheless, the majority of the school board authorized me to go ahead with the repairs. We are going ahead with them. We are as shocked as you that the low bid comes in actually $100,000 more than the original estimate. But as my memo indicated to you, there was a ballooning of problems as the structural engineers got into the design work. So that my request is essentially to ask to allow us or to give us authority to reassign the $71,000 that was returned to us from the asbestos removal insurance monies, and to allow us to add that to the money we already have in our budget for this project. We will still have some money that we have to make up, and we will have to use it from our contingency or some other funds.
Before I ask the council for any particular clarifications, is there anyone else who wants to speak to this particular issue? Mrs. Reed, would you come down to the podium and let the audience know who you are, although I'm sure they know who you are.
Thank you, town councilors. I would like the town council to know that I did make the motion at the school board meeting requesting that this item come to the town council, and the safety of the portables is one issue, but one of my big concerns is that the zoning board and the planning board only gave 5-year lives to those buildings, and my concern is if they are not in up to code and safe, then we may lose the use of those before we get our money's worth and before the time in which we need them. And so I feel that this is an extremely important decision to do right now, and I just would like you to know that I did weigh it very carefully. I don't like to spend money unnecessarily, and I did speak with several people who were disassociated with the project contractors to ask if there were any way that we could do it any differently, and three of them live in Cape Elizabeth, and all of them said, if you can get someone who'll do it, who'll guarantee it, who's safe, and who's solvent, you should go ahead and do it. And that was the basis of my motion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Rosemary? What was the vote?
5-2.
And what were the concerns of the two people who were not in favor of the motion?
The premature nature of the expenditure of funds. One of the dissenters was a member of the Space School Study Committee, and she wanted to make sure that the fixing of the portables was in the big picture. And the other dissenter wanted to I believe, without hearing any specific arguments, just let the council know this was not a unanimous decision.
Any other questions for Mrs. Reed?
Thank you.
Questions for Superintendent Goldman? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. Follow up on a comment just made. Where is the fixing of the portables in the big picture?
The bottom line is that my advice to the school board, my advice to the town council, is that we be guided by code. We cannot get the repair stamped by a structural engineer until we go ahead with this. Therefore, after the vote, which clearly authorized me to go ahead and accept the low bid, we have already started on the repairs.
Do you anticipate requesting more than 5 years' use out of any of these existing portables?
I can't answer that in all, in all honesty. I mean, we will be getting the report by the middle of September. We really are getting down to the wire as far as identifying some of the problems right now. I think what was missing in the picture a few years ago when the community started looking at space needs was the nature of renovation needs. And that will come out very clearly in this report, because we are faced not only with appropriate space, with space,
But we also have the consideration for appropriate spaces for certain kinds of programs. For instance, we have one auditorium, K-8. There's absolutely no way that that, excuse me, not auditorium, one gymnasium, K-8. There's absolutely no way that one gymnasium can service 1,100 kids. It is absolutely impossible. We are doing our kindergarten through grade 3 phys ed program in an inappropriate and, frankly, if it were a new building, unacceptable space. Now, all of those issues compound space. It is not just where you're going to put classroom space, but it is program space that has to be factored into this. So the report that we are now working on will, in fact, I believe, clarify some of those issues for the community, in addition to talking about a host of renovation needs. The portables were seen as a short-term solution. They are a short-term solution, if solution is the word. Even with the retrofit, frankly, the per-foot cost of building and now repairing these temporary structures is around $38 per square foot, which is actually within the square foot cost that is generally quoted for that kind of building. The figures that I was able to get indicated somewhere between $35 and $40 per square foot. What you had was an unbelievably inexpensive structure. I think perhaps
we're learning.
That's, you know, part of the problem is that there were a number of issues that corners got cut in a variety of ways, and now we're faced with the decision of how do we make this code acceptable. I've wrestled with school buildings and school problems for code issues. It's been a difficult time for schools in the last 2 years because codes have been up dramatically. This whole issue of snow load, for instance, was something that has changed in the last 10 to 15 years very dramatically, and it's been difficult for communities to accept the necessity to put in structure with buildings that are standing and have been standing for a number of years, or in this case, where the engineer is saying as far as attaching the portables to the buildings, there's absolutely no question that we have to do something about the snow load. But even in addition, we have overstressed walls, even if they were standing out on a meadow. They would not be as expensive to fix, of course. They would not be as overstressed in that kind of situation. But we do have some marginal issues. I believe, frankly, that the bottom line is those buildings should meet code.
I want to hit some of the financial questions now. How much under anticipated expenditures do you think you're going to be on your new teacher hires?
I think that there is always that issue of when we lose senior staff and hire people who are not as senior, there should be some realization of differences. We have not quite finished our replacement. We had a couple of late resignations, and so we are still replacing teachers. But if that's a question, if you ask me if I should realize in my salary account some savings, is that your question?
Right.
I would anticipate that would be the case.
Do you have a figure in mind?
No, I
without the two hires you have to work on? Okay. That's something I want to discuss with the rest of the council, the savings there that we've seen in other years, and perhaps not consider the full $80,000.
Other questions? Councilor Coxon.
This proposal that you have for the $80,000, is that for bringing up to code all three portables?
Yes. The costs that I outlined in my memo, the $165 is the low bid cost minus the adjustments that we were able to make,
right,
which are certainly minor, but at least in good faith, I would certainly accept those as the best we can do. And that is definitely all three. Now, I am still, and I need to emphasize, that part of our building study is going through a variety of issues, some of them old buildings, some of the other repairs that have been made. We are not at the bottom of getting a handle on where these buildings are. I am satisfied that the building study is going well, and I am satisfied that they're doing a thorough job of renovation study as well as space study, but I just would like to inform the council at this point that the community really does face a lot of problems with these two buildings.
My other question was, what is the life expectancy left of one of these? Are we starting the third year of the first one?
I think we have completed 3 years of the first one.
So we're beginning the fourth year or five-year, quote, approved lifespan?
I believe so.
Thank you. Other clarifications? Councilor Jordan.
I don't know whether it's clarifications or not, but Connie, I want to thank you for coming and trying to clear the problem with previous administrators, and I wish they were here, and my questions would be different. You mentioned the high school roof that needs to be shut down, and is that due to the changes that has come out in the last few years, because it's been there since 1969 or 1970?
Both through my initial conversation when I came into the district to try to start unpeeling the issues, and through our school space study where we've extended the scope of our discussion about structural issues, we have asked structural engineering to check all roof work that has been done in the last 2 years, because roofs now have to go up to R30 public buildings for insulation. And with the age of the buildings that we have around here, if you go up to R30 insulation and don't check the structure, you're very likely to have a problem. Now, they started with the parts of the middle school, went to the high school, went to the portable, and we're still in that checking process as we go through our study. The high school turned out to be structurally pretty good. There's only one section, even though the structure had not been checked and it had been re-insulated and re-roofed. There was one section that if we had more than accumulation of a foot of snow on it, that we have to shovel it. It was too dangerous for our equipment and the experience level of our people to shovel it, so we made an agreement with the roofing company to come in and do it. That's how I know we are not going to find people to come in and shovel off these portables. We tried very hard. Furthermore, the difference between a foot snow on that roof, which is not an everyday occurrence, especially if it's a good windstorm and so on, very different from the situation we faced with the portables, where any snow accumulation, and if you could see how that drips down, that means at least in certain parts of that roof, just about any snowstorm is going to at least raise that issue. That raises questions for us about use of the space. Do we then, how long can we use the building before we get the snow shoveled off? Do we have to have an emergency plan where we put the kids in other rooms while we're trying to find a way to have our people shovel it off, or hire somebody to come in, and we couldn't find people to come in? So we were coping with that last winter. Fortunately, we did not have much snow. There is, of course, we might have another snowless winter, which would be nice, but my advice to the board, and my advice, frankly, to anybody that asks it, is I certainly appreciate that it's a difficult situation to be in. We asked to spend this kind of money to do this kind of a project, but I think educationally and from a code problem point of view, it makes sense to try to go ahead and do it.
We have a council that does everything. It's not even feels a big conflict of interest if we shut it down. My other question is, the previous contractor that built these done it according to what the town asked for? There's no recourse in it, I take it.
Well, no. I mean, in the sense that the project went through without a structural engineer. And you would have to tell me what role the town played in all of that.
Not much.
I mean, that's an issue that has been discussed, and I'm not sure that I can answer that fully.
Has the question been asked or the expert?
Right.
You've already started those projects, I understand, you can have them ready for school, haven't you?
There will be some work that has to continue on the outside and ground level of these structures. They, however, can be cordoned off, and it can be done safely. There will be some noise, some inconvenience, but it was part of our bid specs that the major disruption would be finished before school starts. Obviously, this has mushroomed into a far bigger problem than people thought it was going to be, and there were no simple solutions. I think it's anytime you get into alterations or this kind of repair, getting down underneath an existing building and so forth, it does pose some peculiarly difficult problems.
Run over the budget in the phone, tooth comb to see if there's a few extra bucks in to help offset this?
Well, obviously, we're going, we already, we, it really would be offset in three pieces if you grant my request. One piece is the money that's in the budget anyway. One piece is either contingency or looking at something like the salary lines and so forth. And one piece would be, and frankly, I know it does say 80, but I would settle for the 71 if we're going to do any any discussion. I mean, that was, in fact, money that went for asbestos removal, and you may recall that, I think it was 2 months ago, we were notified that our insurance settlement did bring that money back to us, and it seemed like kind of an appropriate piece to try to cover this unexpected problem.
I thought it was supposed to come back to offset the cost of the projects.
Well, it went back to the bond. It's just sitting there, as far as I know. It's not doing anything.
The school board, school department, for parking purposes, if nothing else, parked the expense of the asbestos abatement into the bond account. So those were expended out of the bond account. When the proceeds came back in from the risk pool, they were reapplied to that account from whence the funds had been parked.
Oh, I didn't talk to you out the links right now.
Other questions for our superintendent?
Everybody understood everybody, I think.
It was in there, and then they took that money and put it back in.
Yeah, the money for the asbestos abatement cleanup after the roof leaked was paid for out of the bond account.
Yeah.
It was charged off to that. Really, without a whole lot of authorization, the asbestos had to be abated, the roof needed to be fixed. It was left uncertain where the funds were going to come from in order to meet that expense, whether or not it would be a responsibility of one of the contractors involved, or whether or not our insurance would cover it. At first, our insurance didn't cover it, and we have a rider through Lloyd's in London, and they did agree, after much discussion with the MMA risk pool people, to cover it, and then they may be subrogating it against others. But in the meantime, they have paid the claim, and the funds have been advanced to the school department. Is that any better?
Yes.
Thank you.
Could I have a motion on item number 54?
Kind of a motion you like that? I agree with all kinds.
Try one.
Try one?
I'll second it.
Oh, jeez, wait a minute.
Much as I hate to, but I believe in safety, and I believe in the education of our children, my grandchildren.